Today, Tutankhamun is the most famous name of all these ancient kings. But during his lifetime, historians believe he was insignificant.
He was a kid, 9, 10, 11 years old, the little-known, relatively minor pharaoh.
Yet Tutankhamun's tomb transformed his fate.
This young boy king became one of the most powerful symbols in Egyptological history.
Tutankhamun's tomb is just 4 small chambers, each no more than 14 feet wide. At the heart of the tomb is a sparsely decorated burial room, modestly painted and with no carvings. Hidden in the walls, mysterious niches once held sacred statues. A Shabti, to come to life as the pharaoh's servant, and the jackal god of the dead, Anubis. Tutankhamun's burial chamber is filled with magical decoration. But beside it, the rest of the tomb is left bare. This simple tomb is unlike any other royal tomb in the valley.
All of these things conspire to make Tutankhamun's tomb unlike any other in the Valley of the Kings, and we can't be sure why.
Today, Kent has a rare opportunity to study the religious texts inside Tutankhamun's burial chamber up close. He searches for clues that might explain why they're not as elaborate as other pharaohs. Kent works with a team carefully conserving the delicate decoration. Lori Wong has found mysterious anomalies in the way the ancient walls have been painted.
If we notice here, at the very base of the wall, you can see that there's drips running down. Throughout this tomb, we have drip marks. So it suggests this very fast, fluid action in terms of the application of the painting materials. Also, what's really unusual is that in this small burial chamber, each wall has a slightly different painting technique. It's unusual because one would expect in a small chamber that the painting technology would be the same from wall to wall.
I'm with archaeologist Dr. Richard Hansen, exploring the jungle ruins of El Mirador, a massive pre-classic Maya city that may have been controlled by a powerful dynasty known as the Snake Kings. And Richard is about to show me the evidence.
Whoa! Are you kidding me? Look at this.
This is the Grand Acropolis of El Mirador, once home to the most powerful families in the city. The entire plaster-covered plaza collected and channeled water for the city's residents. Along the walls are 2 26-foot panels covered in pristine Maya sculptures.
And what's exciting for us is it has the entire cosmology of the Maya. For example, if you look up here, the great rain god Chak.
The rain god.
And the rain god. The feathered serpent. Here's the feathers right here. And then you have this old god, the great creator god Itzamna. Their entire deity system is here.
It is so well preserved.
This is a stunning revelation. The mythology of the Maya was thought to have been conceived during the classic period, or even partially invented by later Spanish priests. Yet here it is, carved in plaster 1,000 years earlier. And at the base of the frieze, another shocking discovery.
Here we go.
Wow.
What I want to show you those here. So what you're looking at, this is the eye of a serpent. It's got its open mouth here. Here it has a fang here and a droplet of venom. We believe that this symbol, since it's such an important symbol of a serpent, is one of the earliest symbols we have of the Snake Kingdom.
Wow. I mean, we see this snake symbol
1,000 years later.
1,000 years later, hearkening back to the Snake Kingdom.
Exactly.
And here it is.
Here it is.
When Parliament commissioned this clock in 1854, they demanded that Big Ben should be the biggest, the most powerful chiming clock in the world. And, most challenging for the age, accurate to within 2 seconds per week. But there was a problem with making such a giant clock accurate.
The clockmakers of the day said you just couldn't do it. Our minute hands are 14 feet long. So in a good gust of wind, They act as like sails. And clocks before this time, the wind would catch the hands and the hands would drive back and make the clock inaccurate.
The secret to stopping strong gusts blowing the hands out of time is a set of heavy weights that pull the hands round as they drop. Two swinging arms keep the weights dropping at the correct speed by pushing the pendulum, which sets the ticking speed of the clock. The pendulum turns a ratchet wheel once every second, which releases the weights by a precise amount so they can pull the clock hands round at exactly the right speed.
That's amazing, guys. There's fabulous detail, just even so quickly. That's just incredible.
After hours in near freezing water, we're eager to make our way topside, thaw out, and examine the scan.
What do we got?
How cool is that?
Hey, it worked.
The combined scans from above and below have come through crystal clear, giving Caroline and Richard the most accurate model yet of the mysterious underwater feature.
You can really see the pattern of it, really.
Absolutely, it is. It's that very distinct outer part of the circle.
The oldest henges, they occur in Orkney. Well, they have to be inspired by something. Our work here tells us that they would have seen this on a land surface.
The formation we saw underwater, so reminiscent of the banks and ditches of Stonehenge and Stennis, may in fact have been the reason for their existence, as the people migrating south sought to emulate the site here.
It's impossible to ignore how similar it is in some ways to these henges we see on Orkney and other places. Do you think this is a part of that story?
The henges mimic it so closely. It's got the platform, the ditch, it's the same sort of size, but natural.
Yeah.
Is it a coincidence that we get something like this where these sites are developed? It could be a mother henge. It turns everything on its head. You wouldn't think it would be the genesis of something as magnificent as Stonehenge.